tell you a story about me and you. Out on the water, surrounded by the blue. They scream that only I'll be saved. They toss off the line that I just let float away. Yeah, I let it float away. I let it float away. I let it float away. Float away. Float away. Yeah, I let it float away.
If you're not with me, I'd rather not be safe. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is Tuesday, May 17th, 2016. And the start was a little bit longer than usual, but it doesn't seem like anyone's joining at the moment. Not sure if people are all just kind of on a hangover over all of the NVIDIA news and stuff that's been going on, or otherwise busy, but they're not here. But we'll start anyway. So let's get started. This is the last day of the week. Week counted from Wednesday to Wednesday. Excluding Wednesday, because that's the day the podcast is on. For the place I work. Excuse me. Okay. So, what we're doing last time... Whoops. Well, what we're doing last time is we were talking a lot, but other things we were doing last time was preparing to set up movement controls. And one part that we're seriously missing is the ability to validate what is a possible move. And there's a couple ways of doing it. I'm thinking what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna have the Peace class. Is interesting. It's not updating. There we are. I'm guessing it was just because I had another monitor selected, so I didn't want to do a refresh. Unreal Editor is actually pretty good about cutting its frame rate down to like seconds per frame when it's not maximized, so it doesn't kill performance, right? Because there might be, for example, some time where you want to have the game launched as a standalone and have the editor. Well, if you minimize the editor, you don't want the editor's gunk to you know, its process and its the stuff it does to, if you're profiling, mess up the profile, even though you should close it anyway. If you're profiling a program, you should close everything besides that program apart from their profiler, right? But it minimizes as much as possible by that. And if you're just doing something else, you don't want it to go and churn your GPU or churn your CPU, drawing frames you're probably not even looking at, right? But then goes full speed when you're focusing that window. Anyway, so we're trying to validate which moves are which, and I'm guessing what I'm going to do is on the piece, the generic piece object that then gets subclassed to pawn or king or whatever, have it give a list. It'll communicate with the game state, because it'll, no matter where the piece is, it'll always have access to the game state. Be it server, be it client, whatever. If they're out of sync, then we're gonna have some problems, but that's bug, it's not gonna like crash or anything. You're just gonna try to give a command to the server, and the server's gonna say, what are you doing, right? This is impossible. But we're using all reliable functions that should never happen. At least not up to typical lag situations. Anyway, so yeah, we're gonna have the piece, probably be the piece, see what all the possible moves are, and from there return a list, and then wherever we could be a game state, we can do that too, I don't know. And then have the return list be all the valid moves. So when we want to check to see if a move is valid, all we have to do is say, here's your piece, here's your here's your piece, here's your starting location, or here's your destination. Is this destination by location, by coordinate, the same as anyone that this piece represents? And if it is, then it's a valid move. If it's not, then it's not, right? So we don't have to do another loop through it. The piece just returns it. And I'll show you what that would look like here. So let's make the AI first, so the AI will skip its turn. So you see, I'm hovering over some part of the of the level. If I move over and I press select, it turns green. Or if I select it, it turns green by double clicking. There would be blue tile, because it's a pawn, there or there. If there was a piece to eat there or there, then it would be red. Or whatever I choose. It was blue, I'm probably going to keep it blue, but, you know, depends. Whereas if it was a bishop, and the bishop was selected, it would have, these would all be, or this side would be blocked, because it's a friendly piece. There's nothing back here, it's map edge. So we'd end up having this one, this one, this one, this one, and this one highlighted, but not this one, because it's out of range of the king. It can't move there. And likewise for the queen, same idea. When I select it turns green, this, 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 and this would be blue. Unless there was a piece to eat, in which case the piece where it is enemy piece, let's say it's there. This would be, well, blue, 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 red, and then nothing, because it can't go past a eaten piece. At least not with any of the current pieces we have. There might be some special piece that we end up later for, you know, DLC or fun game modes or whatever. But the queen, because it's a queen, would also be able to go up to here, up to map it, up to, not map edge, up to king control edge. And the king couldn't move anywhere because it's blocked in on all sides, but that's okay. But how it works is, or how it will work is, we're going to get a coordinate for here, for there, for there, for there, for there, and for there, for there, for there, for there, for there, for there, for there. When we get it on selection, it'll turn all of these tiles to its movement. Color. And I forgot what I was going to say after that, but anyway, let's do that. So is valid move, destination instigator. No, let's actually have it be a be in the game state. Do I want to be in the game state? Okay, so yeah, I want to have it in the game state, and it makes sense to have it on a piece because the piece will know where it is. But at the same token, the list of tiles, the list of pieces, sorry, the list of tiles and the list of pieces are in game state, and so I mean, I'd have to access. It would either be from game state peering into piece, or from piece peering into game state. It's kind of, you know, the same thing either way. And there'd be nothing that the game state would need from the piece that it doesn't already have a public accessor for. Whereas the game state, I mean, you could publicly access these arrays by asking for it, but instead of just doing level tiles, it'd be game state slash, or game state arrow level tiles each time. It's a bit more wordy, right? So, yeah, let's do it from the game state. Tender tile, process move request is valid move. And we'll have T array F int vector, because we don't have a special coordinate system anymore. We're using a standard F int vector, which is again a bit wasteful. It's three integers instead of two, but meh. F int vector. Get possible moves. A piece. Stick it around. Let's call it Instigator still. I really don't care. It's not, you know. It may not be. Well, it's instigating the action, but it may not be instigating, like. It may not be attacking something. It may just be moving somewhere, but it's still instigating the action, so let's call it that. And then in game states, we will. Kill this out. T-array. F int vector output. Then we'll have T array F int vector. Hello. Not bad, how are you? So F infector, first level moves equals instigator. And what did I call it again? Oh, well, that moves. That's where it was. Thought I F plus move. Why did I change it from a F infector? Well, I know F plus move has the type of move in it. Oh, because I want a lava recursion. Why do I want that? Oh, one thing that this would let me do is if I had a, none of the original six, but if I have a new piece and I want to move like one space for up, back, forward, sorry, forward, back, left, or right, but infinitely diagonally up till the king range or whatever, then I would allow recursion on any given direction individually. So, okay. And let's not play this one. There we are. Lots of swearing in the one from what I remember. Then type of move is whether it's an eat, a move, or a move and eat. This is gonna be a little bit harder to deal with than I originally thought, but that's okay. So I guess I did have a possible move. I'm gonna have it be F in vector for the get possible move though. Because I don't need to know whether it's an eat or a move, because I'll have the context just from a location. Once I get the list, right? So I need more information to build a list, but once I have the list, I can infer what I need. If possible, move. There we are. So first level moves, okay. So now we have a list of first level moves. We can then loop through it. So 4 into 32, I equals 0, I less than first level moves dot num, I plus plus. So in case what you're wondering right now is I'm trying to think about how I would structure this. No, I didn't hear about that. So, okay, not going okay, not feeling sick today. Still got an annoying cough that went away though. Sorry, I must have missed that quote, that comment about 5 minutes ago. Sorry about that. Did you hear about tuition-free computer science school called 42 that's opening in the U.S.? No, I did not, actually. I will look it up now. And again, I'm going to mute the audio for a second. So this is TechCrunch. I'm gonna make sure there's no like ad or something that's gonna play that'll give me a copyright notice. No music, so that's okay. So I'll turn the music back on. Let's go back here. So Coding School 42 plans to educate 10,000 students in Silicon Valley for free. So Xavier Neal. I heard that guy before. Maybe not, he's in a French ISP. Well, founder of a French ISP. Net worth is 10 billion. Nice. I apparently did some adult content. Alright. So 100 million US to create a new school. 200,000 square foot building in Fremont. 24/7, 1,000 IMX. Welcomes all students between 18 and 30. Create a computer science version of Hunger Games. They call it swimming pool because they want to see if you can swim by throwing you in, figuratively. So 4 weeks, code for Monday to Sunday, day and night. After those 4 weeks, best students get to study at 42. So basically to get into 42, you have to do a game jam, which is, you know, not necessarily a game jam, but... Nice. Interesting. Yeah, I'm very big on education, but yeah. So bool recurse equals first level moves I dot be allow recursion. And then we're going to get any given direction and keep extrapolating from that point. F int vector direction equals first level moves i.destination. I'm pretty sure I don't account for the pieces. Current location when I do that. Do I? If I did, I was kind of stupid. Pretty sure I did not. Allowed move. Okay, so I do. But I do it in such a way that I can circumvent it. So in the, for example, Peace King, build moves, I do, maybe. Okay, so there's one thing I'm gonna think of. Is there an easy pattern for doing a while loop exactly once? Pattern while loop allow one. That's probably not what I want. I mean, there's ways of doing it, like having two flags, if they're both true, do it. If either of them are true, do it. And then in the first run, and during every run of the loop, just set to false. So that way it runs the first time, and then it goes out. But is there an easier pattern for that? So start location, if I just make a start location be zero. Oh, I see a bug. It looks like I don't compensate for the piece having a recursive. Maybe I do. Yeah, no, I do, because that would be taking in here. Yeah. No, it's not a bug. Okay. Because I'm building up not a list of locations, I'm building up a list of move tokens. Okay. So what's my problem then? F int vector 0 value, and we'll have F int vector start location equals Start location equals instigator location. Just have it be there's a word I'm thinking of, thesaurus start. Origin. Source. Origin seems like it's origin or start. That would be origin might as well. So it's a gear location. Right. Okay. So direction is first level moves to destination. Be run at least once. That's true. While or better, will be recurse. True. While B recurse, B recurse equals first level moves I dot B allow recursion. There we are. Because it'll run at least once let's not have it be recurse. Let's have it be running. There we are. Because then it'd be confusing, like, you would be calling, setting it to true, even if you're not going to be recursing, but yeah. So be running is be allow recursion. And then we will keep looking through it. So this direction is that. Type. Move type. Equals first level moves I dot type of move. Okay, so be running is be allow recursion. Then it will be um, if it's vector current destination or current location equals origin plus direction. That should be right, because f in vector. Oh, I have to do it up here, actually, sorry. F int vector current location equals origin plus equals direction. Let's see if Epic implemented this. Did Epic implement plus add for fn vectors? They did! Yay! Okay. So plus equals means current location equals current location plus direction. So, these two statements are equivalent. It's just a bit more compact. Now what, so we'll do can enter tile. So let's see, is can enter tile, what does it do? Okay, so it, accounts for, all of the, it won't allow friendly fire, it will allow, eating, it will allow moving, but it won't, you know, yeah. So that's good. What was it called again? Canary tile. If, oh, see ya, Eric Needy. Canary tile, what was your arguments again? You know what, let's just have it be, a split. So, location and instigator. Current location and instigator. So if we can enter the tile, then we need to determine whether it is an eat or a move, and then see if we can do that, right? How does it do it again? Probably get piece of coordinate. Yeah. Yeah, get piece of coordinate. We know it's a valid tile because it returned true, so we don't have to check that again. AP's target, get toward creation on there. I don't want it to return, because this is not a return sort of thing. So if we can't do it, then we do continue. And let's just have it be like that. Because, yeah, we're not going to be saving much. Actually, it would already do that. So I just need to have... Because Canary Tile would already check to make sure it's an enemy team. So I don't even have to do that. So if target, we know that Canary Tile will take care of that for us. Gatala coordinates, current location. And actually, I wouldn't be able to, as I was saying earlier, maybe if I, you know, have a piece that would want to keep going, even if it hits something, gets shielded by something, I wouldn't be able to do that anyway because of how this would be programmed. And even then, I mean, you wouldn't really want to have a piece, unless you're doing a special move like a knight charge, you wouldn't want to have, which would be a different path anyway, you wouldn't want to have a piece that can go through a shield recursively, right? Because then you just put it in line with the enemy king and they kill it, right? A piece, get piece of coordinate, current location. If there is a target, type of move, equals E move type, eat, or type of move equals E move type eat or move, then we will add it. Outputs.add current location, and then we will stop it from recursing, so B running equals false. Else, if type of move equals E move type move, or type of move equals E move type eat or move. I think Canary Tile will actually have to also take care of, I'll have to extend it to see whether it's in, King range as well, but, yeah. Output.add current location, and I'm not going to shut down B running because you can keep recursing as long as it's still a valid tile. So in Canon or Tile, I'm also going to have to get the the Instigator Pieces team to see whether it's a allowed tile. So there we are. Let's see in Player Controller how I did that. Updating range tiles. How do I do is within control? I think this might be a bad idea. So I'm adding it to the tile to see whether it's in range or not. That could be a problem for multiple players on a single So if you're the player on this server, it's actually modifying your copy of the tile. So the server would be able to see all the players allowed So I did it wrong, but okay. So let's see, is within control. I guess I should say has control over. Yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna have to think of a bit of this a bit harder. Why did I do something so stupid? I wanted to be a state on the tile so I can just call restore material instead of doing anything special. Alright. Okay, well, let's fix that. And I wouldn't have to fix the material. This is gonna be really hard for multiplayer. I mean, it wouldn't be useful for cheating because the server wouldn't have access to grabbing it. Oh no. No, actually, this would be fine because, yeah, okay, so I do a check to see if the current player state is a player state. So if the server's player wasn't allowed, then it wouldn't work. Oh, yeah, because it's in the player controller, so the server's player controller would not pass this, so it would immediately go and blank everything. So it would blank everything on the server side, but it would allow everything on the client side, so that would actually work. Okay, that's better. I mean, the server could inject client moves, but it could do that anyway because, you know, it's a server, the game state's on their computer. So, can enter tile. Oh, it's up here. Oh, I wouldn't be able to do that for the AI, though. I would need something separate for the AI. Let's have it be first. So, T array A piece. Current. Instigator team pieces. Okay, so, 4, in 32, I equals 0, I less than... we should have this be a separate function, I think. T array a piece get team pieces. A piece instigator. Oh, you're kidding me. Visual Studio. Let's try recovering this files. This is longer than just redoing everything, I think. Oh, is it already? Oh, it already let me in. Okay. Pieces. Get current player pieces. Number of players. So it crashed in the middle of trying to create this. Wait, well, IntelliSense is being a nuisance. Thanks, IntelliSense. Is something I think really would make a lot more sense as a generic function, because I mean it's a small chunk compared to what this has to be done, but you know. As a matter of fact, I can probably remove this chunk and just call get team pieces for that team. Oh, it's not even team I want, it's get player pieces. Shoot. Well, I'll figure that one out when IntelliSense. There we are. Get player pieces. Get player pieces. Get competitor pieces, I would say. Weird. Oh, okay. So here we're gonna have to traverse the tree of teams and competitors, which I didn't really like doing, but it's clean. And when we find that spawn number in any of those competitors, spawns can only be assigned to one competitor at any given time. Multiple of them can be assigned, but any given spawn can only be to one competitor. I can just give the rest of that list, right? So, I'll give the entire list, so, yeah. So, 4 into 32, I equals, actually let's do here, int 32 spawn equals instigator. Come on, piece. Your spawn is spawn number. Zero I less than spawn. Sorry, yeah, whoops. Teams. Dot num I plus plus four int 32 j zero j less than teams dot or let's do f competitor current sorry f team current team equals teams I j equals zero team j less than current team dot members dot num j plus plus that's not supposed to be all supposed to be semicolon f competitor current competitor equals current team dot members j four int 32 k gotta love nested loops k less than current competitor dot assign spawns. It's a triple nested loop, and you think, oh god, no, but I mean, that's... We're talking about a total number of entries that is equal to the number of spawns in the level. That is, like, right now at most 10. So, it's just split up in a variety of possible ways, right? If spawn equals int 32 current spawn equals current competitor dot assign spawns k if spawn equals current spawn return current competitor dot assign spawns. Okay. Or dot assign spawns. Oh, I want the, you know what, whatever, let's go with it. I wish I would have arranged this a bit better. Get compare pieces. And 32 spawn number. Return T-Ray a 13. So then we will have a, why are you complaining? Oh, that's good, okay. So, T-Ray, a piece, get competitor pieces, int 32 spawn. It seems odd, but you think, why would I get spawns from a spawn number? I have a spawn number, right? Well, it can have multiple, right? So the idea is to, if this spawn number is by itself, actually, we should have here UE log error or log class error text. Cannot find this spawn. Assigned to a competitor. Accessing disabled spawn. Yeah. Let's make it a warning, why not? Competitor pieces, T array in 32, competitor spawns equals, get competitor spawns spawn. Anyway. Silly Visual C++. Making sure I didn't accidentally type out, right? Yeah. So 4 int 32, I less equals 0, I less than level pieces dot num. I plus plus, I'm trying to think of where I want to have it be done by pieces or by spawn, but. Okay, now I know something's screwed up because it's definitely defined. It's one of your values. Oh, I see what the problem is. A base game state. It's funny when the problem's not where it says it is. It's like, these variables don't exist. Well, because, yeah. I'm applying to a class that I don't realize. So I notice people are coming in the, coming and going in the chat. If you have any questions, this is a very informal stream. Ask away, don't worry about holding me back or anything like that. In this case, I'm hoping the product will be the stream, so if you want to talk or anything like that, that's what it's for. If level, or int 32 level current spawn equals level pieces I assign spawn us. Whatever. If current, that's right, competitor spawns dot, let's see if there's a dot contains. Okay, dot contains, current spawn. So instead of having to do a double nested loop, I can just do a contain and it would do the loop for me behind the scenes. It probably is literally just, like, if I peek the definition, it probably literally is loop through all entries. If equals, then return true, else false. Sorry, if it goes through a loop, then return false. Or it'll crash until it sends, and I'll really hate myself. There we are. Yeah. So for the list of data, if data equals I am, return true, else return false. That is literally what it is. So if it contains, then we will, T array A piece output dot add, level pieces I. And then return output. Now this should build. Actually, no, it won't, because I was writing something halfway through. Whoops. Well, it should tell me where I didn't finish. There we are. So canary tile, if pieces equals get competitor spawns Instigator spawn number. So, instigator. Whoops. Pieces. Skater. Instigator. Team pieces dot num. I plus plus. Okay, now we have all of that. Bull be in range equals false. If instigator team pieces I dot is within control. Location. Be in range. Yes, true. And then break. If not be in range, return. So I'm looping through all of the instigator's pieces, which really should only look for the kings, but if I make another piece that has control like king does, then that would be allowed. I should actually, right now, do an extra check. I'll probably check elsewhere, but, yeah. Destination in range. Cool. Sorry, be in range equals false. Four, and then I'll just copy this again. Origin in range. And it will be, instigator dot location. Location, skater pointer location. Skater point location. And again, we return true because we don't have to look through every possible piece if one of them's in range. What are we gonna do if I have it's double in range or triple in range? It's in range or it's not, right? So that's good. So now when we go to whatever we're doing over here, you have the same chair as me? Costco? Hero is what I was in. So now, get possible moves is gated by this. This will prevent out of range. Yep, cool. So now we have a list of get possible moves. T array F int vector. Possible moves equals get possible. So how do you like this chair? I've not been too much a fan of it. Had to tighten up the armrests because the first time I got it, it ended up slicing through the plastic and the back almost fell off. But now when I sit down, I don't have that problem anymore because we tightened it so the back's now secure. But sometimes when I sit down, I feel like I'm actually pushing a screw down into the base of the chair. Wasn't much a fan of this chair. So what do you think of it? Why is it freaking out still? For in 32, I equals 0, I less than possible moves dot num, I plus plus. I haven't had any problems with it, just think it's too, don't think it's too comfortable. Just keep a pillow in it when you're up against it. Okay. Yeah, I didn't find it that uncomfortable. I mean, there's a lot of padding on it. I found after a time the padding started to go away, but it crushed. But I didn't really have too much problem with the comfort, apart from the fact that the back seems a little bit too far back. I have to lean back to get into it. Anyway, I just found it very glitchy, and this is the second one I had because the first one we ended up having returned because the back was falling off. Literally, the back was falling off. So if possible moves I equals destination return true. And there we are. We now, assuming everything works, we now have the functionality to so the back being too far back is why I get the pillow. Okay, so it's not just me then. Oh! I forgot to return the output. 1 second. Now we have whatever I just said 30 seconds ago. Yeah, there we are. It's all possible moves. It's gated by whether it's in range. If it's an eat or move, it'll add location and stop recursion. But if it's a move or eat or move, if there is a target there, so if there's a piece there, and we know from canon or tile that it's gating whether it's, so it won't allow friendly tiles. It'll return false. So if this tile location here was a, here, had a friendly piece in it, this would entirely return false. So all of this would go away. and then it'll keep going and adding direction to it. If it was a recursion, then it would just say allow recursion is false, and it wouldn't run again. But if it's allow recursion is true, it'll keep running until be running is false, or canary tile is false. Should actually have this here. Be running equals false. This would be an infinite loop if I didn't have that. There we are. So now we have all of the possible tiles we need. We will then be able to add a material to the tile such that it will respond to movements and stuff like that. Let's do that right now, why not? I was thinking of doing it, starting it for another time, but... eh. Yeah, sure, let's do Blender. Open, I'll, hide what I was working on. See Unreal Projects assets? No. Models. Tile scaled, is that it? Oh, no, I don't have to do that. Don't have to do that in Blender. What am I doing? Forgot. I added that in the class. Right. Tile here and tile here. There we are. So I'm gonna have two auras now. This will go above and beyond. Or do I want the other way around? Oh, no, I can't really do that. So what I would want is, let's delete this. What I want is, I'll show you. What I want is, what am I doing? I already loaded that. I'm actually gonna have to load a regular check-it as well, the old check-it. It's to show you what I'm doing. So this is the old check it, this is the new check it. So in here, as you see, we have our enabled world, and we have this little hover cursor that kind of floats around in it. And we select something, it turns green, and it can move around to select what we want. And then we can select something else, we can deselect, so forth. Well, in the old check it, select a piece and whatever we move will glow that allowed color. So if we click on the queen, we can now move like this. So if we have it like this, then that comes out and we move it like this. There we are, that's a safe move. You'll see that we can eat this, move there, move there, move there. I didn't have selection or the selection aura or the hover aura because I just had to be clicked, but now I have that too, so I have to think of some way such that all of those will interact on a single aura in the correct way. And as you can tell, as you add more and more conditions adding on to one one state, which is the color of the material you're dealing with, the more complex it gets, right? You start adding more and more conditions, and you'll have actually factorial pairings. One condition is one possible pairing, two conditions, two possible pairing, three conditions is six possible pairings. You can have, so you can have A, B, B, C, A, C, I was thinking backwards, but it'd be three possible pairings because order wouldn't be independent. So it'd be three possible pairings, and then if you have four conditions, then it will be, have a 4 factorial is that'd be 24, 12. So it'd be A B A C A D B B C B D so and C D. So it'd be 6. Anyway, regardless, so you have more and more conditions in it. Yeah. Die, horse! Anyway, so you'll have more and more conditions, so it's getting more and more annoying. Oh, I can do a rest aura. Okay. So if B client arranges that, so I can just set values on that tile. Okay. This is maybe not so bad. Again, I may need to actually be client move. Okay. And then be client eat. Be client eat. And these should never actually be together. So what I should really do is make an enumerator and be empty. Sorry, Should we make a enumerator and have this state be I should have an enumerator, but I'm not going to. Screw it. If B client move. B client move. Return. Turn F linear color 1.f. 1.f, sorry. 1.f. Else if B client move. Maybe else if. Color 0.f, 1.0f, 1.f, 0.9f. So return red, return blue, return empty, and return an aura. This is a really ugly way of doing things. Now on selection, not player state, player controller, sorry. So on selection, select location, camera select material. T array F int vector possible moves. I'll always be lonely, I'll never be fine. If
life is a movie. It's always so boring. Where is the story? I hope it gets better with time. Yeah, I hope it gets better with time.
So, if selected tile, or what was it again? What was that? Get tile at coordinates. You know what? I'm just gonna do fix me for now. It's almost 11. Fix me, make this only affect selecting a team piece. Selecting a piece. Currently, possibly ever, this is the only way to select a tile. But I don't know that, so yeah. A piece selected piece equals get piece at coordinates. Game state. Get piece at coordinates. Selected location. If selected piece possible moves equals get game state. And what did I just do? Okay, there a tile. It's get possible moves. This is ugly. So 4 and 3, 2. I equals 0. I less than possible moves. Got num. I plus plus. If get piece at coordinates, so game state coordinates possible moves I b sorry get telecoordinate. Get tile at coordinate. Game states, get tile coordinate. Game state, get tile at coordinates. And B clients eat equals true. Else. Move equals true. And then in the deselect location, Yeah. so this is no longer valid. Need to reset a lot. Sorry, all tiles. So, 4 in 32, I equals 0, I less than game state level tiles, level tiles dot num, I plus plus, what's going on? Level tiles. I dot B client, sorry, B client, eat equals false, level tiles I B client move equals false. And then level tiles I restore material true. Oh, game state. So we do a tile current tile equals game state level tiles I. That'll save a bit of lookup. So instead of doing 3 lookups to game states, well, instead of doing 5 lookups to game state, we do 3. We cut down 2 of them. And this should work. So let's close this down. See if it builds. Oh, that won't work. I was gonna do the same thing where I cut it down, but I wouldn't cut down anything because I'm still doing single lookups. I'm looking for a piece here and a coordinate here. Getting the fn vector, I mean, even the compiler could probably get rid of that. So let's see, now when we select pieces, we should have an ugly but a material applied to them, and when we deselect it, it should go away. Fingers crossed. Either way, it's 11 o'clock, so meh. Anyway. AI this, because why not? So now we have things we can just move around the level when we select. Nope, nothing. Maybe there's an issue with, we'll see. Huh. Maybe there's an issue where this is taking present. Oh. Okay, so it's not refreshing. So it's working. Just not, so this is probably there, right? So it's not being restored. Okay. Well, first off, I have an issue where I screwed up. And it's supposed to be 0 to F. And let's do a bit less than that. Let's do 0.7. Let's do 0.6. And 0.6. And for some reason, restore material is not being called on selection. Did I forget to call it? Oh, I forgot to call it. That would be a problem. May have just been I forgot to add a call. Whoops. Now let's try it. And I'll also add it to there we are. Let me select. There we are. There we are. Okay. And this should show nothing because there's nothing I can select with it. And now I need to have something where if I have a selected tile and I select one of these, I'll make it move there, but whatever. We'll deal with that next time. Right now, all we need to do is, and let's not be around the bush here. I programmed this pretty terribly. It's kind of likely you may see me in a week or a month's time or a year's time, whatever, being like, why did I do it like this and then reprogramming it, but whatever. It works now, so let's do git shell to cd c colon backslash unreal projects check underscore it git status git add a git commit m add piece selection with materials with UI. So there is that. We now have, it doesn't do anything yet. We haven't made the move occur yet, but we now have a list of all possible moves for any given piece. Even recursive ones. And they show the correct material. For fun, let's actually go into test level 1 and let us add a piece. Let's add a a pawn here deliberately from the wrong team. So it's isolated off, there's no king in that range, but that's okay. We go splash check it, we start the game. And we do AI, there we are. AI will give up its turn as usual, that's okay. Now there's a really weird, oh! Right. I forgot that the default value is to not give it a team. This is deceptive. It's actually supposed to be spawn number 1. Save. And there we are. Splash check it. AI 262. There we are. I was gonna say, what's wrong with preview lighting? Okay. So now when I select this, there we are. I have the ability to, well, I can't do anything with it yet, but it now shows enemies that can be eaten with the red, and you can see that can't go past it. It stops at that enemy. Let's actually add that to Git. Git status. Git add content. Git commit. Add dummy piece for eating. And actually, while we're here, let's also test the other way around. That means we should have a piece that's in the middle of nowhere that should be out of range. I don't know why this would be wrong, but if it is, that's a problem. So we see here is our range extends from here and all the way over here. We have one of our pieces that we, oh, we can select. That's not a good thing. Maybe we can fix that. Yeah, I can't do that. I forgot about that. So, I made a goof. So in player controller, in select location, get tile coordinates at location, if selected tile, animate tile select. It's not chess, it's check it. The comment was eating in chess should be capture. Eating, I guess, is checkers, but yeah. I'm not gonna refactor that out. Holy crap, what happened there? Is weird. Here I was thinking I was gonna end on this song, but I'm gonna miss it for the next one. And actually, that was the end of this album, so I'll start on song number one again. Nice. So the selection part here, where did I select? Am I ending? Yeah, probably very soon. I should have already ended. So I end at 11 o'clock. As you can see, it's now a bit after that. So, I've been streaming for over 2 hours, which is typical, but yeah. So he's merged here and in the... Two hours is common for me. Where do I live? I live in Ontario, Canada. So can select piece. So can select piece is needs to be a bit more valid. So can select piece. This location includes select pieces, if not selectable there. Okay, so just so everyone knows, typically what I do for this, because I also have another job and stuff, I have a job and stuff like that, this is not a job. If this is a job, I would have in the last 3 months made 35 cents. Hoping it will be a job, but 35 cents, sorry, 10 cents a month is not exactly a living wage. Especially since YouTube doesn't pay up to get 100. and actually my YouTube's down the bottom there as well, so if you want to see the past videos. But the idea is, as it goes on, especially if once I release a demo, hopefully people will see the stream and be interested in it. I'm maybe changing this at some point. I've been saying that for a couple weeks now, but what I try to do is I try to do 5 days a week. For about 1.5 to 2 hours per day, usually 9 p.m. Eastern through to 11 p.m. Eastern, around there. That's not what I meant, Yeti Breeder. well, Game of Designing, oh, you haven't seen it yet. So, right, the game is called Check It. So back in 2014, November through 2015, I made a game that, this is the old version of it. Looks like chess, but there's a couple of differences. The AI was dumb, actually, in the other map, it would despawn some characters. And I say other map, you think, well, there's a chessboard. Like, what could it be, right? But anyway, let's do this. Let's grab the queen. Let's move it over here. Sure, why not? And then I can move it in, eat either of those two, whatever. But also the pawn can move in any direction, including left, right. You know, so it can move in any direction or eat in a diagonal. And the reason for that is because when we have other maps, like cross streams, we're not in an 8x8 grid anymore. We are in a arbitrary grid. This is 64x64. It has a bridge. Yes, I made the bridge. I did not make any of these assets though. These were like Polypixel or Infinity Blade. T array, not standard array, is an alias. Okay, so T array is Unreal Engine 4's implementation of it's actually standard vector, based on vector, I should say. But yeah, so I use that. That's what Unreal Engine 4 really wants to use. A lot of stuff is based on it, so that's what I use. And the enemy spawns over here. So as you make moves, everything is in range of your king. So these pieces are not. So I'd have to move my king over to get the knights. That takes moves. At the same time, if the AI was smart, it would either A, be collecting its knights, or B, trying to move in the city to get a good position on you. And as you keep moving over, eventually you'll be in range, and now I can select this knight. Can't select this one, but can select this knight and move it in. Now if I move one more side, then I can select both knights. And then you can also get other pieces through the level, like if you get to the, there'd be a castle here. If you get inside the castle, you can get the queen and kill the other queen. So you'd have two queens, the other team would have one. So how many per team, or is it just one versus one versus one? Okay, so this is the thing with a new one. So that was the old version, this is a new version here. That was one versus AI. It was supposed to be a demo that I would release to get viewers to stream. Eventually did the relaunch because I was able to license the music. long story short, I did the relaunch and I'm starting from scratch again for the last couple months, and this is where I'm at right now. So let's say this is a map that has 10 spawns. I could, if I want to, assign the first 5 to AI and the second 5 spawns to me on team 2. And then it would be 5 spawns of units versus 5 spawns of units. Good. Or maybe I want to have a little bit of handicap there. Maybe I want to have it be 5-on-3. Or maybe I want to just comp stomp and have it be 1-on-3. Or maybe I just want to have some fun and have 2 AIs, 1-on-1 team, 1-on-the-other, and I just watch them battle. That could work too. There is also, this doesn't work right yet because it kind of crashes, but my intention is, how many are a squad? So, I'll show you in a second. Actually, you know, I'll show you right now. So, I won't finish what I was doing there yet. I'll get back to it. But as you see here, no, it would vary by the level. So the question is, how many are in a squad, same as chess level? It varies by a level, but all of these pieces are assigned to a spawn. So this is, spawn number one, spawn number one, spawn number one, spawn number one, spawn number, spawn number one, spawn number one, and, as a test unit, spawn number one. So whoever is assigned to spawn number one, whatever team they are, whatever type of player they are, could be AI or a person, they will be assigned all of those units. In this case, they won't have access to this unit here because it's out of range. And this is all spawn two, spawn two, spawn two, spawn two, spawn two, spawn two. And the king has control range of 8, so anything within range of 8, the tile will be open and available, and you can select any of those pieces. But, if you then have another spawn over here, another spawn over there, another spawn over there, and they all have their own pieces, if you sign, let's say, you have 4 spawns there, 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 and there, and they each have their own units, then you can have, you know, 4 players, 1v1v1v1, or 2v2, or one player can have these 2 spawns, the other player can have these 2 spawns, so it'll be 1v1, but starting from 2 locations each, or whatever. And, this is the thing, I'm also allowing players to be on multiple teams. So let's say, this is what I was going to show you earlier, let's say we're in a level here, and we have, or in the menu here, and we have now multiple people spawn. I think this is 2 spawns. So if we look in here, now we have multiple players. I can have it be AI on here, and player here. I can have player 2 be on team 1 and player 2 be on team 2. So we'll have team 1 will have AI and player 1. Team 2 will have player 2 and player 1. Team 1 will have AI and player 2. Team 2 will have player 1 and player 2. So you'll have the team, the teams. The number of teams will be a number of spawn points, right? So in this case, it's 10. I want to allow it the free-for-all. In this case, there's 10 spawns, so I'm limiting it 10 to 10 teams. Once I actually design, like, get a structure for maps to be designed, someone could make a team with, like, 20 or 30 or 40 teams. A map with 20 or 30 or 40 spawns, in which case there'd be 20, 30, 40 possible teams. Currently, I have a limit of the number of materials I can assign, so the number of colors I can show, and that is 10. 10. If I go above that, I don't have a color to assign, it'll just be like black. For every team going on. Once I fix that and add more and more distinguishable colors and materials, like maybe some will have like a stony marble, some will be metallic, whatever. Doesn't matter. Then I can have as many teams as spawn points. I don't care. The idea is, I just don't care. I want... I mean, there'll be competitive modes, so there'll be some presets and stuff like that where, like, this map works good with this. And actually, I should probably make it an interface. But anyway, where this map would work good with this, this map would work with that. But as it stands right now, I want, or in general, I want people to be able to assign it however they want. If they want to have three people where one versus one and their person on both teams, you know, person one gets spawn 1, 2, 3, 4, person two gets 5, 6, 7, 8, and person three gets 8 and 9. Eight's on team, 9 and 10. 9's on team one, 10's on team two. You'll have 4v4 with one little crap disturber on both teams. Why not, right? Like, that's if the people setting up the game want to do that, have fun, right? So, yeah. Pirate PvP games are cooler, okay. Yeah. Can't do models well enough? Eh, that's just, that's a little bit of, yeah. 3D modeling's a bit of a challenge, but it's not... You'll get used to it, right, once you do it. And you can also make 2D games as well, of course. But yeah, that's the idea is, like, I want people to be able to assign however, like, the map however they want, right? I shouldn't get in the way. If someone wants to have fun where they have one versus one and one person being a crap super, go ahead, right? If they want to have free-for-all or competitive, I'll allow that too, right? Of course, that comes into some issues where you might have, some things are just too difficult to program, but whatever, right? It's not playable right now. It's barely, like, I can't even select units yet. I just started doing that today. I'll show you what I have today. I'll disable these. Oh, I can't even do that anyway. I have to stop the game. Crit number spawns one. Yui does have... okay, so... Any 3D engine can support, well, any non-restricted 3D engine can support 2D. Set your projection to orthogonal, and your Z depth will just be the order of layers being shown, right? Now, is it easy to make 2D games is the question, right? Depends. Like, if you're comparing it to RPG Maker, RPG Maker's gotta be easier to make RPGs. If you're talking about, like, you know, Illusion of Gaia, probably Unreal Engine 4 is easier, right? I say Illusion of Gaia, it's kind of an RPG, but it's an action RPG. It's like a Zelda-type game, but anyway. It does support you 2D development if you want. Any 3D engine can, as long as they don't, like, literally give you no tools to script it well enough, right? But in this case... Can I call into the show? I don't have any call-ins right now. I'm not sure how that would work. Mostly because I don't want to edit afterwards. So if someone, whoever it is, says something bad on stream, I have to kind of put it to YouTube verbatim. I don't necessarily want to be liable for everything everyone says. On the other hand, it'd be kind of cool to do so, and I'm not sure how frequently I have to edit things out. It's possible. Unity is easier, personally, it depends. I've used Unity as well. I like Unreal Engine, mostly because I've been using it since Unreal Tournament. 1. 99. Then again, I've also seen some people, well, first off, when I was doing audio editing in audio application in Unity, it was much easier than audio application in Unreal Engine. And I know of some people who are like published game developers. One of them worked on Lego Universe as a senior graphic designer. senior graphic programmer. And she turned into indie and uses Unreal Engine 4, but thinks that Unity is a lot easier to make quick content with rapid iteration. So she's actually considering going back to Unity or whatever. Then I see some people with Unity who are like for example, the guy who made Bombernauts was talking frequently about having troubles where Unity would just break something between versions, and they don't give you source code unless you pay the high-end license. So you're screwed, right? You don't have anything, right? You have to wait for Unity to fix it, and they may fix the next version, but that next version, they may break something else, right? Whereas in Unreal Engine 4, you get to access some source code. So it's ease, openness, trade-off. There's a bunch of trade-offs to be done. I chose Unreal Engine 4, you choose Unity. It's good, right? The main important thing is to create, and that's the thing, is if you want to express yourself, express yourself. The tools, you can get into arguments over the best type of hammer, the best type of wrench, but as long as you're creating, you're fine, right? Those are my degrees in the wall, yes. I have a degree in physics and a degree in education. I was originally intending to be originally I was intending to be a prof of physics. Didn't exactly like the research aspect of it. I liked like private research and research development and stuff like that. I did not like the public part side of it, public research side, where you basically, having people look over your notes all the time is kind of, it's not even looking over notes, it's just the way around it. I could deal with it, but I didn't really want to, so near the end I went to get an education degree after my physics degree. And realized I didn't really like Can't Send Children in Space, video game character children, maybe? Do Kerbals count? Send Pirates into Space, okay. That would be interesting. Kerbal Pirates! Pirates are real. that aside, it wasn't really good for me. Not for the education side. I actually really like teaching, as you can probably tell if you see enough of my streams. You'll know that I actually like, fostering a creative mind, having people create, helping people with their issues. But there's a lot of other things that high school teachers do that I did not really want to, so I went another direction with that. Kerbal Pirates. Aaron too nerdy. I'll be nice. Oh, that's actually you're making fun of the name. Okay, so you're making a pun, okay. Right. So I forgot Aaron too nerdy. So they left earlier, I didn't realize they came back, but yeah. I'm talking without thinking, so let's just keep that in mind. Not hitting, but do I have a lisp? Not really. The biggest thing actually is I have a very like this is like been assessed, right? I have a very bad short-term memory. So the problem is that when I start talking or whatever, I often forget about what I'm saying mid-sentence. And then that makes me kind of stutter or whatever, trying to recollect my thoughts, because my mind's just gone at that point. I don't know what I'm talking about anymore, right? So, have I considered getting a lisp? No, I haven't actually. What is this chat? This is the Check It live stream chat. Literal answers. Literal deadpan answers. I'm into teaching. Have I thought of making tutorials? it's not... I have a... Okay, so... My actual job right now is as a journalist for a computer hardware website called Peace Perspective. And what I'm working on right now... I showed this last time, but whatever. Right. So what I'm working on right now is... a explanation video for how multiple GPUs work in a system. So the video is here. So I'm doing
Crossfire and SLI allow games to load balance across multiple GPUs. It is basically impossible to do this in OpenGL and DirectX 11 otherwise. Vulkan and DirectX 12 provide game developers with the tools to implement it themselves, but they do not address every limitation. Trade-offs always exist.
So that's kind of the tutorial style video I'm doing is... I already have a script, I'm actually working on it. I had to take a bit of a diversion for the GTX 1080 launch, because that's a lot of work. Yeah. One of the commenters, or one of the chatters say, they have ADD, and they totally get forgetting what they're saying mid-sentence, and can get annoying when dealing with hundreds of other codes. Yeah, I can. In my case, the issue seems to be stemming around dyscalculia. And the idea behind dyscalculia is... like dyslexia, dyslexia is not an issue with reading or writing. Dyslexia is an issue with recognizing what's on a page, right? There's a big difference between being able to read and being able to comprehend the physical symbols on the page. There's a couple sisters to that disorder called dyscalculia and dysgraphia. I think there's a couple more as well. They're constantly reassessing all these things, whatever. And dyscalculia is what I apparently have. Not gonna get too much into that, but the idea behind that one is it's mostly to do with mathematical numbers, symbols, and stuff like that. Doesn't mean I have a hard time doing math. It just means that what I read on the page might not be what's actually on the page. I could read 25 and see 52 because I either switched the number around or saw them backwards. A 5 looked like a 2, a 2 looked like a 5, right? Or if I'm, when I was a cashier at a store, if I see $12.31, I might say $31.12 because I read the change before the sign because those numbers were transposed. It also has a couple of other interesting side effects. For example, dyscalculia... people with dyscalculia have a hard time typically recalling names, except for the first letter. So if you are trying to talk to Adrian, you may not remember Adrian, but you may think it's Adam, you may think it's, you know, Aaron, you may think it's whatever. Because the A you remember, the rest you don't, and it's frustrating, right? But you can always get that first letter right. And then also there's a couple other things as well, like very poor short-term memory. That is like, it's not like, you know, your average intelligence is down, whatever. It's like, your average intelligence is up here, your short-term memory is way down there for some reason, right? If you do the multiple intelligence test. Oh, be nice. Do I have a girlfriend and wife? I try not to go and talk about my personal life too much in this stream, but yeah, I do have a girlfriend. I'll kind of leave it at that, but yeah. I have a girlfriend, I've been dating her for a long time, years. And also the funny thing is about dyslexia, dyscalculia, dysgraphia, whatever, they all usually come with ADHD as well. Have you heard of Super Serious Records? I have not. I don't understand the question about tucking, and I am assuming that's probably a good thing. It sounds like a euphemism, so I'm not gonna go there. So You know what? I'm gonna call it a night for tonight. It's almost 45 minutes past what I normally do. Thanks everyone for watching. I'll check out the SoundCloud afterwards. But for the time being, thanks for watching. And I usually do 5 days a week, couple days a week. Counting from Wednesday to Wednesday. So I usually try to do Thursday through Monday from 9 p.m. Eastern to 11 p.m. Eastern. But sometimes I start late, sometimes I go long. If I can't do a specific day, like I don't usually do Tuesdays. But yesterday was a 1080 launch. I had a lot of work, so I cut Monday and did it Tuesday to have my 5 between Wednesdays. I don't do Wednesday, as I said, because the place I work, PC Perspective, PCPER.com, has podcasts on Wednesdays. And I'm rarely on the podcast, but just in case, I like to keep that day open. And also, I like to be involved in what my work does, so why not, right? And thanks for enjoying. Please follow if you want to see that again. Or follow me on Twitter. I talk every time I start the stream. And if you subscribe to YouTube, which is free, obviously. I don't like how YouTube calls subscribe. It should be follow like everyone else. Because if you say follow my YouTube, or sorry, subscribe to my YouTube on Twitch, people think you're just asking for money when you're not doing that. On Twitch, you would be, on YouTube, you aren't, right? Whatever. But yeah, if you subscribe to YouTube, great, you'll get access to all of the previous videos since the relaunch. I'm hoping that I might actually bring some of the old ones. I do have some of the ones where I created chess pieces on Blender. Recorded, I might just add them to another playlist of some sort. They need to be on the podcast more often. Thanks. Yeah, so 5 days a week, unless that changes, 2 hours a day or so, and from there. So thanks everyone for watching.